It's my great privilege today to be able to interview Dr. Emery Stoops, a man who's made a number of important contributions to the Rossier School of Education, but also to the profession of education itself. And this has occurred over a great number of decades, actually. And to establish a context for the interview that we're going to have here in a moment, I want to begin with a few quick points about his history. One is, and I think this is most impressive, he's actually had what I count as four different and distinct careers, beginning with that as a wheat farmer, and then another career as a teacher and administrator, a third, and the primary focus of today's interview, as a USC faculty member, and then finally, in his longest career actually, has been post-professorship as a business person. But here are a few highlights of his life. One is he was born in Pratt, Kansas in 1902. He reminds me that that was the year that Bob Hope and Charles Lindbergh were born and that gasoline was 4 cents a gallon that year. He obtained his baccalaureate at the University of Colorado in 1930 and then became a teacher and superintendent of the Richfield, Kansas schools. Shortly after, actually, came to California, where he became a teacher at Whittier High School and then Beverly Hills High School, and during that period obtained his graduate degrees at USC, his master's in 1934 and EDD in 1941, both in education. Gradually moved into administrative work, was principal of the University Adult High School in Los Angeles, and then from 1944 to 1953 was the administrative assistant to the LA County Superintendent of Schools. At about that point, when he was 50 years old, became a professor at USC, where he remained until 1970 when he retired. During that period, he published over 60 articles, a number of books, and probably most remarkably, led Phi Delta Kappa, an educational fraternity, into an international prominence. As he began as a member in 1932 with the USC chapter during the 1950s. In 1954, he actually became the national and then the only person to hold both national and international title of president in 1956 when Canada added a chapter, and has maintained steadfast allegiance to PDK and endowed a lectureship, in fact, that began in 1962 and continues today. After he retired at USC, then started his fourth career, which was in business, and actually it's been his longest career. A very successful businessman, which has enabled him to become an important philanthropist. He and his wife, Joyce King Stoops, they've endowed 25 scholarships at USC in the School of Education, as well as endowed the deanship. And I think the point at which I'll stop on this is to note that in his 17th book, The Psychology of Success, he recommended never retire, which are words of wisdom that he adheres to yet today. So Dr. Stoops, I really appreciate your willingness to meet today and to talk about your career. I think what I'd like to begin with is a question: how did you come to California? What drew you to Southern California?
I came to California because I had been going to University of Colorado, where I got my bachelor's degree, in the idea that my mother wanted me to go into the ministry. I had gone a year to Phillips University, and there, before I could train to be a minister, I had to have a high school education. So I went to Pratt High School, and was about 4 years older at that time than most of the students were. But my father bought a home there in Pratt, Kansas, and it had a cellar, which was a bedroom. So after supper, I would get down and I would study hard to make up for what I had missed in my elementary school, which was not kind of, well, it was really in a way a disaster, because the Board of Education in that elementary school hired an old man who had one arm and couldn't work, like using a pitchfork or a scoop shovel. So they hired him as the teacher, and he liked to talk to the eighth grade students on history and the like that he liked. But as the younger people, he turned out for recess all the time. And so we were never taught reading and the 3 R's, you know, like they're supposed to get in the elementary school. So I had to go to the county superintendent to take an examination after I had studied hard at home, and I passed that. Mm-hmm. Then in high school, I studied hard and became valedictorian of high school graduating class. And then on to college. And I had heard, after I had gone 4 years to University of Colorado, that of the 300 outstanding graduate schools in America, that probably a couple of them might be the best in the West. And I was told that University of Southern California and Stanford and perhaps University of California at Berkeley were really outstanding. So I chose USC because I had an uncle who had gone there and recommended USC very highly. And I liked the climate in Southern California. Mm-hmm. So in 1931, I came out to do my work at USC.
So your initial job was as a teacher, and you were also pursuing your graduate studies at the same time?
Well, it's interesting. People would say that I can't hold a job because I was a teacher, a counselor, a vice principal, a principal, and a superintendent in public schools. And it wasn't year after year, but sometimes during the year, I'd go from counselor to vice principal, mm-hmm. or something like that. So I had quite an area up and down of work in the public schools. And then I was an evening school principal at University High School, and they had a big auditorium. And the West Coast Artillery wanted to go somewhere where they could show pictures to their soldiers. And it just happened that my school had the biggest auditorium that they could use, so they used that. And the draft board told me, well, you're doing a better job maybe taking care of the soldiers here than if you were a private singly. But of course, at that time, in World War I, I was 16, too young. And in World War II, I was 37, but it was 18 to 35, and I had 3 children. So I was told with the draft board, go home. You're doing better by handling this West Coast artillery, and you're a little too old anyhow, and take care of those children.
Mm-hmm. Remarkable. And then what was your transition then to the University of Southern California as a faculty member? How did that occur?
As a let's see, your question is, how did it occur that I went to University of Southern California?
Well, what was the trajectory from being a student to an administrator to then becoming a faculty member? How did that progress?
Yes, I was asked by the Los Angeles County Superintendent of the Schools, C.C. Trillingham, who headed the county superintendent of schools, the biggest in America, and he liked to have an administrative assistant who he felt could be a writer and write a magazine article every week that would be handed out to all the little towns, about 113 in Los Angeles County, where they would publish a shopping guide. Well, they wanted someone to write articles, and the usual person that was handling that paper wasn't much of a writer. So they would pick up my articles and publish them. So that way, and then those would be copied and sent to our office. So I had a whole stack of articles that I had written there for all of these publications. Then I did write other articles for national magazines later on.
And then, whoops, how did you make your connection then to the university as a faculty member? How did that come about?
Yes, I had taught one summer at the University of Southern California, and I was told that I'd have a class of about 20. So they put me in a bungalow, and I went there and was ready for my class. But they lined up down the sidewalk like you wouldn't believe, because I was teaching at that time counseling and had written a book on counseling. And the teachers wanted to know how to counsel primary, upper grade students or high school students. And they filled the auditorium, and I had something like over 300 in that big auditorium. Well, they had a range of interest, and I was teaching on counseling, so I had them divided for up to primary, then the higher school, and then high school teachers when they had to make the decision of going on to university or into a job. So those groups would meet specially, and I'd meet with them from time to time and try to keep them going. And that worked out very successfully by having those different groups rather than my getting up and talking to them about something that was general and it wouldn't quite fit any of them.
So were you the equivalent of an adjunct professor at that point then? This is before you became a tenure line professor?
Yes, that was before I became a professor at USC.
Okay. And how did you then become a professor? What happened to bring you aboard?
I became a professor at USC because I had been invited to teach at a couple of universities elsewhere, and I was administrative assistant to the county superintendent of schools, and my job there was to go out and work with schools anywhere all over the county when they invited me to come in and talk to the faculty about counseling and guidance and so on. Because I had written a book, Counseling and Guidance, my 17th book.
You wrote the book even before you were a faculty member?
Yes.
Wow. And that's what brought you aboard then. That was instrumental in bringing you as a faculty member.
Yes, I think it was, because later then, I was invited to come to USC as a faculty member in teaching administration and supervision. And it just so happened that I was 4 years older than all of the people in administration, the professors, and supervision. But in other areas like elementary education, secondary education, and so on, there were about 32, I would say, on the USC faculty. And I was the oldest one. But they're all gone. I don't know of a person living. But some of them have gone to other situations, I guess. But of that 32 faculty members, I'm the only one. They're still living. Wow. They're either dead or they moved elsewhere that none of them are there. That were there when I was there, but they were 4 years younger than I.
Remarkable. So you were here during a period that roughly coincided with that of Dean Melbo, that he came aboard, I think, the same year you came. He came aboard as dean, and his tenure lasted throughout your period here. So what are your memories of the most important things that happened during during the period you were a professor?
Now, your question is about the one dean?
Well, the question is, because you were, because your tenure as a faculty member coincided so closely with that of Dean Melbo, and that was a period of a lot of growth, I think, for the School of Education. What are some of your more important memories of that period?
Well, interestingly, I have worked under all the deans of the School of Education. William B. Rogers, Osmond R. Hull, Dean Melbo, then there was scattering of in and out for a while. At the Dean Melbo years, I guess one of the most important things was that I was head of the Department of Administration and Supervision, and Dean Melbo was very good in speaking out to groups outside of the university, but on the internal side, he wasn't as popular as he was outside. But he ended up having been a great dean, as all the deans were in some special way, and I worked under every one. Up to the present dean, who is the first woman dean, let's see, Karen Seams Gallagher, the first woman dean, and I think one of the greatest. Mm-hmm. Is present dean, and I've worked under every one of them.
Mm-hmm. That's a remarkable history. And as you think of your period with Dean Melbo, what were some of the more outstanding things that occurred during that period? Some of the events that really stand out in your mind?
I think maybe one of the outstanding things that I did while I was working under Dean Melbo, that I happen to have rather large classes, and that I have as high as 50, 80 some, quite often, and at the end of the semester, I would say, well now, before the last session, I'm going to have you doing some writing, or we'll have you answering verbal questions. And then on the last session, we're going to have a big dinner. You can bring your wife or husband or a friend, and we'll have a social committee of this class. In fact, I had them each time have a president, a vice president, and a social committee chair. And we'd open the class with the president opening the class, and then he'd refer it to me, or he would call on something else. So we would have this great dinner at the end, and that was a very fine, interesting occasion. And we found one place, General Lee's in Chinatown, that served us very, very well, and they had good music and dancing after the dinner, and that's the way we would end. And that happened under Dean Melbo.
So it sounded like you had an important social role within the school, with the, to really kind of pull the students together. A lot of what you did was social with the students, to help them identify with the school, with you, with the profession.
One thing I did that was different, and if I had a class 35 or under, and I did have several classes like that, I wanted those people to be have good human relations. And one thing I did was that I would say, I'd like for you now in this class from here on, and I'd do this about the second or third time they met, to come to the same seat each time and to know every person in the class. And I'd say one way we can do it is this. you're sitting in a curved section here, which they were, and I want this person to give his name and this person to give his name and your name. And this person give his through the class to 35. And I would say, now just to show you that I think this is good relationships, I'm gonna name them. So I name all of them, and I want to remember your name and call you by name mm-hmm. during these days that we're going to have to have together in this semester. And that worked beautifully.
So we've talked about your teaching a little bit. I guess I'm curious also about your work with Phi Delta Kappa, because you made a very substantial contribution, I think, to that organization. How did you get involved with Phi Delta Kappa?
I was invited to join Phi Delta Kappa in, in 1932, I believe it was. I became a member. And then Osman R. Hull was dean of the School of Education, and I had working with Phi Delta Kappa, and we were kind of short on teachers. I got a little film made by a man who made the film on a teacher, and I worked with him on that, and the teacher was Mary somebody, and I changed the name to Mary Dean in the film. And then the country seemed to be kind of short on teachers, or realizing the importance of teaching, and Phi Delta Kappa chapters throughout the country bought that film, mm. Our Teacher Mary Dean. And then when we went to the next biennial council, they wanted to run me for vice president of Phi Delta Kappa. Mm-hmm. And my sponsor, Dean Osman R. Hull, said, no, don't jump the chairs. It would be better for you if you would be head of the the district representative, and there were about nine districts of Phi Delta Kappa in the United States, and he wanted me to head as head of District 2. And so I did, and when I did, we had California, Washington, Nevada, New Mexico, that area, the southwest corner. And they didn't pay the district representative any money at that time. They do now, but I got in my own car. And I visited first every chapter, and there were seven of them. Then I felt, well, now we ought to have new chapters in places University of Hawaii had never had a chapter, and I had taught there a summer, and so I wanted to get a chapter at University of Hawaii, and that would be off the continental limits of the United States, but it really wouldn't make them international. And I wanted also to have an international chapter, so I traveled to University of Mexico and over into Canada a time or two. And I didn't get an international chapter, but I did double the number of chapters in District 2 in the 7 years that I was there. I went there when there mm-hmm. were seven chapters of Phi Delta Kappa. At the end of 2 years, we had 14. And I had to be at the inauguration of the establishment of each chapter when it was new. So I was very busy during those years in doubling the number of chapters. And I guess maybe that's the end of the story there. But we did become international later on.
Well, you became president of the organization at some point.
Yes. When I advanced to district, from district representative in one of their biennial council, they had an opening for national treasurer. And I ran against the man from the east, northeastern and eastern district, which is District 4, I think they called it. And I beat him by 8 votes. And then when I became president, I was a national president, but I was able to get a chapter at University of Toronto in Canada, and that was international. So I am, to this day, a past national president, dash international president, the only one of those that ever has, or is, or ever could be, because I was both national and international president of Phi Delta Kappa.
Did the school recognize the work you were doing? By then you were a faculty member.
Yes.
Did the dean and your colleagues support you in any way for that work?
Yes, they did. Being president of Phi Delta Kappa, and when I first joined Phi Delta Kappa, that was the only support group of University of Southern California. But later they added Educare and two or three other groups that were support groups. So yes, Phi Delta Kappa was highly supported all the way.
Good. What form did the support take for you? Did the dean give you course release, or how did the dean support you for your work?
Well, the dean was very supportive, particularly Dean Osman R. Hull, because every 2 years they would have a national council of Phi Delta Kappa, and they met in Chicago, and Dean Osman R. Hull was quite outstanding, and locally was president of something in the local hotel. He was just a strong man. And then when we went to the biennial National Council of Phi Delta Kappa, he was nominated to be president of Phi Delta Kappa. Mm-hmm. And also there was a man from it's on the west side of Lake Michigan, University of Minnesota, maybe, was also nominated. Well, I campaigned for Dr. Osman R. Hull because, after all, I was working under him at USC, and he was elected. Mm-hmm. And the other person who ran against him was two other men from the university. He got on the plane and started across home, and their plane fell in the lake, and they were never heard from again. Then Osman R. Hull, when he was president of Phi Delta Kappa, set up a teacher recruitment commission, and he named me to that teacher recruitment commission. And so I got this film developed, our teacher Mary Dean, and that was sold all over the country. Mm-hmm. And that popularized me. And that's one reason that I beat out the man that I ran against as treasurer. Mm-hmm. Then the next council, I believe it was, I was elected president. And that was in 54, I believe it was. And Phi Delta Kappa started in 1906, and they were going to have their 50th anniversary celebration. And I was president that year and head of that 50th anniversary celebration. And it was a great affair. And I shouldn't take time to tell you everything. It was held at University of Indiana. But one thing that happened that was significant, when I was elected president, I met with my board, and for a good many years, Phi Delta Kappa was located in a warehouse in Hometown, which is a suburb of Chicago. And I said to the board, I said, now, we've had a building committee every year here for quite some time. Would you like to have it another building this year? And said, oh, yes. I said, okay, I'll follow your recommendation. You are the building committee, the board of Phi Delta Kappa. And I'm going to name Dean Chauncey, I think was his name, as chair of your committee. And this is what I want. I want, when we meet 2 years from now, that that building is going to be completed. And we must find a site, and we must find ways of financing that building. And that probably will mean, instead of Paul Cook, the executive secretary of Phi Delta Kappa, that you have a business manager under Paul Cook, and then you're going to raise the money, choose the site, and have the building started, or maybe even built by in 2 years. And what happened was that the building was built. And I was president, and I had worked hard to get an international chapter. So we got, let's see, the chapter in Canada. Let's see, I named it a while ago, I guess.
Toronto.
Yes, University of Toronto, where we established the international, first international Phi Delta Kappa chapter, and that delegate was at the great celebration that we had in the 1956 meeting, celebrating all of this thing, and the building was built. And the president of Indiana University had told his staff in architecture to give Phi Delta Kappa all the help that could be given, and they secured the site of the building and gave us a very cheap land cost, and it was dedicated then, since we had it completed. And as the president and head of this great celebration, I felt that in making my final address, I should be Lincolnian and make it short. Mm-hmm. And that was interesting because in the afternoon of the last day of the time we were there in that 50th meeting, the president of Indiana University invited to his home in the afternoon for cocktails. And then in the evening, we went out and stood on the balcony of the new building. And that president of Indiana University and about 30 other great educators from all parts of America stood, and I was supposed to make a speech. Mm-hmm. Well, the vice president introduced me, and he talked longer than I intended to talk. So he got me introduced, and then I made my short speech, and here were these people down here, and it started to rain. And I made mine very short, and they loved it. And my speech then was printed in the Phi Delta Kappa, the National Phi Delta Kappa magazine, and buried under the cornerstone of the new building, where it still is to this day.
So we'll know where to find it.
So I felt very honored.
Yes, absolutely, as you should. To change the topic a little bit, my understanding is the period when you were a faculty member in the School of Education, the school grew tremendously. By one thing I read, it indicated that it may have tripled in size, actually. So a lot was going on then. What were some of the factors that influenced that growth?
The factors that influenced the growth of
the School of Education.
The School of Education.
Mm-hmm.
I think the dean had a great deal to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
When I went there, Dean Lesterby Rogers, I believe, was the dean, and I went first to him, and he outlined a course for me to take. And one of them was his class, and I went to it, and here were principals, superintendents, and here I was just starting my graduate work as having gotten a bachelor's degree from University of Colorado, mm-hmm. and I worked and I studied just as hard as I could, but I made an A mm-hmm. in his class. And from that time on, he and the dean that followed, particularly Osman R. Hull, who followed him, did something different. He set up commissions, and one commission was on teacher recruitment, and named me as head of teacher recruitment. Well, I had helped to build this film, Our Teacher Mary mm-hmm. Dean, and it mm-hmm. was sold countrywide. And so teacher recruitment became a very interesting thing. And I had written articles then on teacher recruitment. And incidentally, a lady who later became my wife, as Joyce King Stoops, was attending a class at Northern Illinois University, and she looked on the bulletin board, and there was a message from the assistant superintendent in Long Beach, and he was asking for teachers. Well, she got in touch with him. He sent her a telegram and said, if you'd like to come to Long Beach as a teacher, we would want to have you. Well, she had a little baby, and her husband was ridiculous, and he'd kind of taken and tried to steal the baby, and she got an attorney to get that baby back. Then she loaded the baby in her car, and headed for the West.
Mm-hmm.
And she became a teacher then in Long Beach, and a vice principal, and a principal. And then she took a course in Long Beach State College. And I have a long background how I was there when it was just a vacant lot.
Mm-hmm.
And she took a course on from Dr. Wayne Young, and I had been his doctoral chairman.
Mm-hmm.
And then she came to USC, and Dr. Elmer Wagner recognized her as being outstanding, and he put her on the faculty.
Mm-hmm.
She started taking courses towards the doctorate, and he put her as a member of the faculty, and she went ahead then and finished the work for the doctorate. And she had her final examination, and Dr. Lloyd Nelson was one of the five chairs on her committee.
Mm-hmm.
The class that I had started in Wiesbaden seemed to be an example in Europe for good classroom teaching, and they invited other professors from USC to go over there. And Dr. Lloyd Nelson was one, and he was on this Joyce King's committee.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the thing that I had started in Europe had spread, and they had asked him to come to a graduation ceremony over there. And he asked me then if I would sit on, Joyce King Doctoral Committee. So I did, and they all asked her a question. They had read her dissertation, but I didn't have time to read it.
Mm-hmm.
Because he asked me, and the next day I had to sit with the others, and it came my turn to ask her a question, and I said, if you were writing this dissertation again, what change would you make? How would you put more? How would you put less? Mm-hmm. Would you change? What would you change? And she liked that a great deal.
Mm-hmm.
And we started across the street, or she did, and I kind of caught up with her. And professor in elementary education had gotten his degree in Stanford, and he was real sharp. And he said, I was walking close to her, Joyce King, and he said, there goes a paradox. Well, everybody laughed, a paradox, because she'd just gotten hers.
Right.
And I was a faculty member mm-hmm. that had sat on her committee. And then she did, was put on the USC faculty
mm-hmm.
in elementary education. So we got pretty well acquainted mm-hmm. and we were finally married.
Remarkable romance in the school.
Yeah.
Well, you'd mentioned Wiesbaden. Would you tell me about that? I think you had some role in setting up some center there, or tell me about that.
Yes, Wiesbaden was the center of the United States Air Force, which reached into northern Africa and covered all of Europe. And so when I went there with the group that I organized in Beverly Hills to take a tour, a student tour of Europe, we stood in front of the Cologne, call it a mansion or cathedral or whatever, with a big street in front, and Hitler was in power. And here on the street, in front of that castle, was a group of young boys, 16 or 17, not old enough to be in Hitler's army, marching with broomsticks over their mm. shoulder. And we found that, to me, if Hitler kept going the way he was, and I came back and people asked me to make a speech in Beverly mm-hmm. Hills Church and places like that, since I'd taken that tour of students to Europe.
Uh-huh.
And I said, unless there's a great change, surely there'll be another world war. Well, it so happened that Poland and England had made a treaty that if either one were attacked, then the other would come to Britain's or to Poland's side. Well, Hitler then marched into Poland.
Mm-hmm.
There's quite a story about that. And Franklin D. Roosevelt was not ready to go to war against Hitler, but England then was pulled into the war, and Franklin D. Roosevelt set up a program of land lease. So if Britain wanted a cruiser, if they wanted cannons, whatever they want, United States furnished that to England So we were the arsenal of preparation. Mm-hmm. And it was so great a drain that in the United States closed the automobile factories and other factories and made war materials, which was sent to Britain. Mm-hmm. And you couldn't buy a car.
So you saw this coming. You'd been there, you'd seen Hitler, the effects of Hitler on the country, and predicted that. And so then to fast forward it to Wiesbaden later on, you went back after the war as a faculty member? Wiesbaden?
Yes, I visited Wiesbaden in a tour that my wife and I made, and I showed her the hotel where we had stayed, and that was the hotel where Kennedy, who was very popular, mm-hmm. and he said, "I am a Berliner." Mm-hmm. And you may remember that statement. And he had the whole third floor. Well, since I was just a teacher with my wife, well, I was given a beautiful suite on that floor, mm-hmm. in the same hotel that Kennedy had stayed in. Huh. But when Kennedy was there, he was going to make a speech, and the people around liked him so much that from 3 o'clock on, they drove in, and no way could all of them get close enough to hear. And so he stayed on the third floor, and that's where my wife and I were given to stay, but we didn't cover the whole floor. We just had a suite there. Wow.
And I thought that you went back as a faculty member and set up some programming in Wiesbaden, that you got some university courses going. Am I correct?
Well, I helped the couple of professors that went after me, uh-huh. but I went only the one time.
Oh, did you? Okay.
But I did something else on the mainland that had never been done. I'll go back to this again. Here okay. I was, a national president of Phi Delta Kappa, uh-huh. and an international president, the only one that ever was or ever could be, and there hadn't been a foreign country with a chapter of Phi Delta Kappa. Mm-hmm. And in the United States, Phi Delta Kappa was started by big college professors in 1906. Let's see, it was 1906? Yes, I believe it was. Yeah, that's right, 1906. But no state college had ever been allowed or invited to have a chapter of Phi Delta Kappa. Well, when I was district representative, it seemed to me that that wasn't quite correct, mm-hmm. because we had state colleges in California that were strong, mm-hmm. and San Diego State was one of the strongest. So I made a study of San Diego State College, their library, their teacher training and all that they were doing, like a big university. Mm-hmm. So I recommended to the Phi Delta Kappa board that was meeting in Chicago after I was off the board. Mm-hmm. Let's see. No, I was still on the board. I recommended that San Diego State be given a chapter of Phi Delta Kappa, and they accepted it. Mm-hmm. So that was the first one. I also recommended University of Hawaii, and one man on the board said, "Oh, we can't do that because it takes," and the Lurline was the main ship between Hawaii and United States. "No, we can't allow Hawaii to have its chapter because how could the delegate get to our biennial councils?" Mm. And one man on the board said, "Well, I taught a class at University of Hawaii, and I flew across because they had a plane that could land on the water or could land on land. Mm-hmm. And okay, that did it. But when I, a chapter was a district representative and recommended a chapter in University of Hawaii, they set up an airplane to send me over there, and I guess it is before jet planes, because I took the plane in Los Angeles to San Francisco, and then they had the only one that I've ever seen or heard of, like they used to have on trains, a sleeping compartment. Mm-hmm. So on that plane, instead of chairs, they had a sleeping compartment, and that was my bed. Mm-hmm. And I left San Francisco along about, I guess, something like 9 o'clock, and I landed in Hawaii at 8 o'clock, and took me directly to the establishment of the chapter of Phi Delta Kappa at University of Hawaii. And that was the first off-campus, off-American soil that had a chapter of Phi Delta Kappa. Right. But I went on a sleeper mm-hmm. plane, the only one I've seen, and I haven't heard of one since.
I hadn't either. What a great story.
Now, I think the Army has provided that kind of transportation. Mm-hmm. And the presidential plane surely would have a place to sleep.
Oh, I would think so. Now, Waite Phillips Hall was built during the period you were a faculty member, wasn't it?
Now, what is your question?
Waite Phillips Hall was built while you were a faculty member, wasn't it?
Yes.
Can you tell us about the planning that went into getting a new building and what life was like before Waite Phillips Hall?
Yes. Waite Phillips Hall was built by a wealthy oil man and millionaire, and he had given the greatest sum of money to build it. And before it was built, they had a blueprint of everything, every floor that would be. And in our faculty meeting, we took a look at the blueprint and decided that our professors would like to have their offices on the 9th floor. And so we applied for that, mm-hmm. and they saved the place for us on the 9th floor. And the 10th floor then was similar. And then the top floor, nobody had really done much about that, and I felt that when visiting professors came to USC and wanted to talk to faculty members in USC, we ought to have a place instead of their coming to a cold office or classroom, that if we had a beautiful office up there, we could have them come to. Mm-hmm. And I gave the idea of having a Phi Delta Kappa office on that floor. Well, people like that,
uh-huh.
but it's going to cost quite a lot of money. And so, well, they thought of something else, and someone said, Emery being a foolish guy, why don't you buy the whole top area?
Hmm.
The top area of Waite Phillips Hall? Well, that didn't seem to make much sense. And yet, it did make mm-hmm. sense. What a beautiful area, what mm-hmm. a beautiful thing that would be. So I put up the money to buy, I guess, most of the top floor.
When you say you put up the money, through your own personal means or through PDK?
That was called a Stoops Lounge. Mm-hmm. And I was going to make it a Phi Delta Kappa area in one corner, at least. Mm-hmm. But they didn't want to sell me a corner. But I had to take the whole floor, or eventually maybe nothing. Mm-hmm. So I took the whole floor, and then the Fisher Art Gallery sent, without any cost to me, great, beautiful pictures all around over the walls.
Uh-huh.
And then they would have special occasions and special classes that would meet up there in the Stoops Lounge. Mm-hmm. And when my wife, being a professor then at USC, and I got engaged, they threw a party and had it in the Stoops Lounge for Emery and Joyce King. Mm-hmm. So that was a pre-engagement party for Joyce and me.
But in what year were you engaged?
Oh, golly, I'll have to go back now. We were married July 3, 1968. Mm-hmm. And the actual engagement would have been a while before that. Mm-hmm.
But the building was finished right during that period. Then,
yes.
Because it was brand new then when you got married.
And the lounge was there.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Great. So where was the dean's office in those days?
What'd you say?
Where was the dean's office?
And the dean's office was on the third floor. And I believe it was Dean Melbo that wanted to put it up on the top, and he took all part of the dean's of the Stoops Lounge to make an office out of it. And then more and more offices were put on the top floor, and then they gave the Stoops Lounge and put it down on the fourth floor. And that didn't have the view.
No.
But it did have the space, and to this day, it's called the Stoops Lounge on the fourth floor. And there's a big emblem on a golden thing on the door of the Stoops Lounge on the fourth floor. Mm-hmm. So there's been the change.
Yeah.
It's taken place.
But you really influenced the building and how it's used through your
yes.
efforts. Yes, yes. Are there particular faculty members who stand out in your mind as you look back on that period?
One of the greatest was Osman R. Ho. Mm-hmm. And he was a great person. And Osman R. Ho had a family, and he was growing older. And I felt a loyalty to him that I probably wouldn't have felt to other members. And when the new building was built, some of the faculty would pay a certain amount of money, like $1,000, to the School of Education and get their names put on an office.
Uh-huh.
Well, I thought that Osman R. Ho, one of our greatest deans, and then he had retired with his family, and he wasn't very well and active, and I thought his name ought to be on the door. Mm-hmm. So I got on the phone early in the morning, and I phoned friend of mine from Kansas, and he was now, at that time, he was a superintendent at Jacksonville, Florida. And I told him that Osman R. Ho didn't have a room with his name on it, and we ought to do something about it. Mm-hmm. And he says, sure, I'll give $100. What would it cost, $1,000? I said, yeah, well, we'll try to raise $1,000. Mm-hmm. So then I called somebody else and somebody else and somebody else. And by 1 o'clock that day, I had 10 people offering to give $100 mm-hmm. apiece to make a room for Osmond R. Hull. Mm-hmm. And so we notified him then that that was his room.
Very much. Someone you really respected to do that kind of work for.
Yes, it was a delight for me because Osmond R. Hull had been meant so much to me mm-hmm. that I just felt that's the thing we ought
right.
to do.
Right.
So we got his name on the door.
Right. Before we start the interview, you asked me to remind you to ask about other universities you've taught at.
Oh, other universities I've taught at. Well, I taught at USC before I was a professor, but we won't count that one. Mm-hmm. And then I took an examination and became a teacher training for UCLA. And because I did that, then they invited me to be visiting professor for a semester at UCLA. Mm-hmm. And I taught a brief time at Stanford, and I taught a summer session at the University of California, Berkeley. Then I taught a summer session at University of Washington. And then I taught a summer session, and my wife joined me in that, at University of Alaska. Hmm. And there it was interesting because they used my book, Practices and Trends in School Administration. And that was my sixteenth book, I think. Hmm. And they adopted that at University of Alaska. And then my wife taught on the other side of the building, and mm-hmm. she looked across at the glaciers, and the glaciers were calving. And she saw one lump of ice come down and splash with the water so high. And then she saw a helicopter go up and land on top of the glacier. Mm-hmm. So she had a better view in University of Alaska than I had. And then she went with me to Concord, I believe it was, Alaska, and something had happened to her flight. And then she joined me, and we flew to University of Hawaii, where I was to be teacher. Mm-hmm. And then she stayed with me there, and just enjoyed, and I started investing, and I bought 4 condominiums from first to last, and she would stay with me in the condominiums. Mm-hmm. And then our realtor showed us a big horseshoe, and the water was off here, and the ends of it went out to the street, and I can't name the street anymore, I used to do it. But the realtor showed me a condominium that we could buy out on the bow of the horseshoe, and the water was right down here. Mm. So I put up the money and bought it. Later then, my wife and I traded properties all around, and she has it now. Mm-hmm. But for several years, 216 Menahuni Shores was the property. And I bought on the west coast of Maui because I had a doctoral student who told me that of all the islands in Hawaii, one of the best places he thought was on the west coast of Maui. Mm-hmm. Haleakala was the great mountain. And over on the east coast, they had the trade winds. And one time, I drove over there, and he was right. One time, I had a hired car while I was there, and one time I drove around the South Island, and I wasn't supposed to do that. But Charles Lindbergh had been buried in a church graveyard on kind of the end of that trip around the mm-hmm. south side of the island. So my wife went and stood at Lindbergh's grave. Mm-hmm. And he had been born the same year I was in 1902.
Uh-huh. It's kind of made the connection on both ends. And I think I'll make this our last question. As you look back on your publications, is there a particular publication that really stands out as one that you're most proud of, the one that's had the most impact?
There's one that's, I think, I not only think, but factually it is the best publication on the state of Oklahoma and the run to the Cherokees trip, which my father made. Mm-hmm. And because it is that strong, I had been who's who in America, who's who in education, mm-hmm. who's who in executives. And then because of this book, Prairie Pioneers, I was made who's who in the world of authors for all time, mm-hmm. in all ages, belong to that world mm-hmm. who's who. Tennyson, name him, I was in that group.
Yeah.
And that was one of my outstanding honors.
Uh-huh.
And I have that book now, Prairie Pioneers, and my father made the run to the Cherokee Strip. My older brother and sister learned to crawl on the dirt floor. Mm-hmm. And my mother was so happy when my dad sold that 160 acres and bought 320 and built himself, mostly, mm-hmm. a two-bedroom wooden home. And my mother had a dirt floor where I was born.
So this book you wrote really has a lot of personal meaning. It's family history, really.
Yes, it is not only family, but of the things that happened there. Mm-hmm. And they called the northern part of Oklahoma the Cherokee Strip. Mm-hmm. And do you want to take time for me to tell you what happened and why it was a Cherokee Strip?
Sure, I'd love that.
The Cherokee Indians were, I believe, in Massachusetts. They were giving a little trouble, and the government wanted to move them, and they didn't know where to send them. Mm-hmm. And so then they decided that the northwest corner of Arkansas and the northeast corner of Oklahoma was a place where they could send a few of these Cherokee Indians, and they sent them there. And then they wanted to open up a place where the Cherokee Indians would have access to travel, and this was a rather wide strip, to the mountains to hunt game. Mm-hmm. Well, the congressmen weren't aware that the mountain men and the trappers trapping furs to sell in Europe had already killed off the game out there that the Cherokee Indians living in the eastern part of Oklahoma mm-hmm. were supposed to get. So then they opened up the Cherokee Strip for homesteads. And that's where my father made the run to the Cherokee Strip. And he is given a different name in my book. And the names of people were changed in the book. But he does tell the story of the homesteading mm-hmm. of Oklahoma, particularly in the Cherokee Strip. And it is published before. It describes a man on a hog farm. And he had a beautiful daughter, and the hog farm was so big that it went up over the hill, and he had a young man taking care of the hogs up there, and he wanted to drill his well deeper, and he did. Whoop, an oil well come up. Now, that was after my book was written. Mm-hmm. And that changed the U.S. Navy on the battleships and airplane carriers from coal to oil. And Britain had always ruled the waves, but now America was the strongest sea power in the world. But that happened just after my book was written.
Good. Well, it's been a real delight to talk to you today. Thank you so much for sharing your story. And,
well, thank
and it's a fascinating
you.
Story. Thank
it's
you.
It's been a joy being here. I'm delighted. Thank you. And I'm glad I was invited to come down.